Putin out. That was the slogan at a protest in Moscow in December 2011. The BBC called it the biggest anti-government rally there since the fall of the Soviet Union. Prior to the rally, its organizer was a man little known outside certain Russian circles, a blogger named Alexei Navalny. He told reporters at the time that Russia was ripe for revolution and that Putin's party was one of swindlers and thieves. Over the next decade, he became known worldwide as a thorn in Putin's side. He was always seemingly being arrested or investigated or tried for one charge or another. Charges, Navalny says, were all trumped up. But he was steadfast, continuing to agitate the elite as he agitated for democracy. Then this happened. Those were Navalny's groans after being poisoned with a chemical nerve agent called Novichok. CNN and the investigative group Bellingcat found evidence that an elite Russian spy team that specialized in nerve agents had been trailing Navalny for years. 5 months after he was attacked, Navalny returned to his homeland, having mostly recovered from the attack and knowing he faced prison time in Russia for a prior conviction. He was arrested on arrival. Today, Navalny is in a maximum security prison where he is in and out of solitary confinement, has little contact with his lawyers, and can only communicate with his family by letters, many of which disappear en route to their intended recipient. He is the subject of an extraordinary documentary from CNN Films called simply Navalny. As award season approaches, the film has generated a ton of buzz and it will air on CNN on January 14th at 9 p.m. It's also available on HBO Max. Navalny's brave daughter, Dasha, joins me now exclusively. Dasha Navalnaya, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
So first tell us, what is the latest on your father's condition? He is, I imagine Russian prisons are not that great.
Yes, well, no one wants to be in the prison overall, but Russian prisons take it to a whole nother level. My father is currently, for 3 months now, he has been in solitary confinement in a penal colony. And it's a small cell, 6, 7 by 8 feet. And it can be called a cage for someone who is of his 6'3" height. He only has one iron stool, which is sewed to the floor, and out of personal possessions, he's allowed to have a mug, a toothbrush, and one book. Currently, he has some bad back problems, and he has been trying to get in touch with doctors, and he's been complaining a lot to the prison guards and the prison administration, but the prison doctor visited him once, prescribed him with injections that are not really helping him, and they're not giving us the medication name, a diagnosis, or even refusing to tell us the name of the doctor who's treating him.
Everybody I have talked to who has been through solitary confinement says it is hell. It is the worst form of punishment. And for 3 months, you say he's been in?
Yes, well, he's been in solitary confinement 9 times now. And what they do to say that, you know, he's not in solitary confinement for such a long time is they put him in for a week, then take him out for 1 day and then say, well, now you violated another rule, so we're going to put you back into solitary confinement altogether since August now. So for almost 4 months now, he's been in solitary confinement.
There's this amazing moment in the film Navalny where your father is impersonating the national security advisor to Putin, and he asks the people who he thinks poisoned him whether they did it, how they, and the guy starts explaining what he did.
Yes.
Я буду звонить сейчас Александрову, Макшакову, Таякину, из каждого буду просить там на 2 абзаца объяснения, потому что мне нужно, почему у нас ничего не получилось, что нужно, почему было плохо, и что нужно сделать, чтобы хорошо.
Это вот я просто себе задавал уже не один раз, кстати. Ну, я оценивал работу хорошую, по крайней мере. Ну, работа сделана как бы, ну, как вот делали, как бы, это все прорабатывалось вопрос. Не один раз. Ну, в нашей работе, сами понимаете, вопросов и нюансов всегда очень много. И...
Now, you know, from a, as a dramatic moment in the movie, it's amazing. But you, how did you react when you're seeing the government of Russia is now admitting that they were basically trying to poison to kill your father?
Right. Well, the thing about the Russian government, I would say Putin's government officials, is that they've been unlawfully doing everything they wanted for so long that their cockiness caught up to them, and one of the people didn't even think that it was a possibility for not a government official to be calling them and asking them about this. They didn't even think it was possible for us to investigate the poisoning and find out what really happened. So I'm happy that Kudryavtsev spoke out about it. I mean, he didn't speak out about it, but he accidentally spilled everything. But I'm, you know, it's like we said in the movie, it's scary because he is probably now in hiding or killed because of that
conversation.
Yes, of course.
And you've dealt with this your whole life. Your mother was arrested. You've had uncles who are in jail. What is it like growing up? I mean, I'm thinking of you as the Stanford undergraduate, and people at Stanford are sitting around worrying about what's the best app that's going to deliver pizza, or how are they going to get the best offer from Apple? And how are you able to maintain the ability to be, you know, fully at Stanford while you have this whole other thing going on in the back of your head?
It's a strange situation. I am definitely managing it more now that I've grown up. Because in middle school, you know, I was still trying to figure out what I wanted to do with my life while balancing, you know, my dad running for president and my dad being arrested. But like I said before, having this incredible support system that's been around me my entire life, you know, my grandparents who are very supportive of what my dad does, my mom who was just a champion and so compassionate and incredible, and a father who is not only a great politician, but an amazing, warm, smart dad, it makes it easier.
I want to take you to that moment where you realize, after he has been arrested, imprisoned, they've attempted to poison him, he's been in a coma, he comes out of this, he decides to go back to Russia. He must have realized that what's going to happen when he goes back to Russia is not good. He's going to get arrested, possibly worse. I mean, they tried to kill him just months earlier. At that point, did you tell him, Dad, don't go back. You're comfortably here in the West. Organize opposition from Germany, from America, from Stanford.
Well, of course, there was this little voice in the back of my head saying, you know, cuff him to your hand and never let go. You want your dad being by your side. But we never had a family conversation of whether he's going to go back. It was always something that we accepted as a family. We knew that he would want to go back. You know, he's a Russian politician. We're a Russian family. You can't do Russian politics from abroad. The last time I talked to him was a year ago on New Year's. They allowed him to have a 5-minute phone call. But you know how you've probably seen in spy movies, whenever there's a muffing sound, you know that the phone call is being taped. And for some reason, the prison administration thinks that we're going to be talking about something secretive during the phone calls on New Year's. So the whole phone call for 5 minutes, it was just going back forth with, hello, hello, can you hear me? Hello, can you hear me? And then just the muffing sound. But I'm happy that the attorneys are getting to see him. I'm definitely, that's something that's making me very happy, is that there's people who, you know, there to see that he is not doing terribly, although his prison conditions are far worse and getting worse by the day.
So I doubt very much that Russian media will air this interview, yeah. But there are ways that things get around. If your father were to be watching, what would you say to him?
I would say that we're there for him and that we're doing everything we can possible to get him out and change the regime and, you know, educate people, and that we're continuing the work that he started a long time ago and that he shouldn't give up.